you please be seated, and George is going to bring our first reading to us. Thank you.
That which was from the beginning, which we have heard, which we have seen with our eyes, which we have looked at and our hands have touched, this we proclaim, the word of life. The life appeared, we have seen it and testified to it, and we proclaim to you the eternal life, which was with the Father and has appeared to us. We proclaim to you what we have seen and heard, so that you also may have fellowship with us. And our fellowship is with the Father and his Son, Jesus Christ. We write this to make our joy complete. This is the message we have heard from him and declare to you: God is light, in him there is no darkness at all. If we claim to have fellowship with him and yet walk in the darkness, we lie and we do not live out the truth. But if we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus, his Son, purifies us from all sin. If we claim to be without sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just and will forgive us our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness. If we claim not to have sinned, we make him out to be a liar and his word is not in us. My dear children, I write this to you so that you will not sin. But if anybody does sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous one. He is the atoning sacrifice for our sins, and not only for ours, but also for the sins of the whole world. This is the word of the Lord.
And Dennis is going to bring the gospel reading to us. Thank you, Dennis.
Hear the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to John 1, verses 1 to 14. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. Through him all things were made. Without him nothing was made that had been made. In him was life. And that life was the light of all mankind. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. There was a man sent from God whose name was John. He came as a witness to testify concerning that light, so that through him all might believe. He himself was not the light. He came only as a witness to the light. The true light that gives light to everyone was coming into the world. He was in the world, and though the world was made through him, the world did not recognize him. He came to that which was his own, but his own did not receive him. Yet to all who did receive him, to those who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God, children born not of natural descent, nor of human decision or husband's will, but born of God. The world became flesh and made his dwelling among us. We have seen his glory, the glory of the one and only Son who came from the Father, full of grace and truth. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you. Thank you, Dennis. Okay, thank you.
Do sit down. Can we start with a prayer? Lord, as we start to look at John's letters today, we pray that we can hear your voice speaking through his words. Amen. Many years ago, during one hot summer, I visited Ephesus. At the time, I was specializing in classical art and architecture at university. So I was blown away by the massive, intricately carved ruins, the size of the ancient city, and the remains of a once vibrant and cosmopolitan city culture. I hadn't yet found my faith. So while I marveled at the classical buildings, I had absolutely no idea of how Ephesus fitted into the early Christian story. Later on, I learnt about Paul's missionary journeys and the importance of Ephesus in the story of the early church. But until I began to prepare for today, I had no idea of its connection with one of Jesus' closest disciples, John. Today, we're beginning a new 7-part series on John's letters. John wrote 3 letters. The first is quite short, just 5 chapters, and the second and third are just a chapter each. But, although short, John is as determined as Paul in Romans to get his message across. But before we dive into this passage today, let's just ask a few questions. First, did John actually write these letters? John probably wrote his gospel between 85 and 90 AD, maybe in his 70s or 80s. John was a very close friend and companion of Jesus, and possibly even his first cousin, who spent the rest of his life then prayerfully mulling over all that Jesus had said and done. John's aim was to distill the essence of Jesus' teaching, and from that teaching, draw out the very deepest spiritual truths of God's relationship with us and with his love for us. John's gospel is extraordinary. It has all we need to develop the closest and deepest possible relationship with God through Jesus' words. So what about the letters? Although the author of the letters, unlike Paul, never identifies himself, right from the early days of the church, it's been accepted that they were actually written by John. This includes a man called Polycarp, an early 2nd century bishop who, as a young man, actually knew John personally. This personal thread of identification and fellowship is a key motif, as we shall see. The letters are written in the same style as John's gospel and contain many of the same themes. And I'm sure as you've listened to the 2 readings, you've already picked some of them out. There is the love of opposites, light and dark, life and death, truth and falsehood, love and hate. If we compare the passage in John, in 1 John, with the first five verses of John's gospel, which we've just heard read, we see that there are some of the same eternal themes. Although I think that while John's gospel starts cosmic in scale, the letters from the beginning are deeply personal. When did John write his letters? Well, following the persecution of Christians in Jerusalem and its sack by the Romans in 70 AD, the surviving disciples scattered throughout the Roman Empire. John chose to go to Ephesus. Ephesus at that time was a major commercial, political, and intellectual center, and the capital of Asia Minor, which is now Turkey. John's letters were most likely written there between 85 and 95 AD, after he wrote his gospel to a group of churches in the area. And finally, why did John feel the need to pick up his pen again and write these letters when his gospel was available to all? At that time, many Christians were experiencing a crisis of faith and even falling away from their faith, in part due to persecution, but also due to the insidious propaganda of false teaching, including a deviation called Gnosticism, which denied the incarnation of Jesus and questioned whether Jesus was both fully God and fully man. I'm not going to go further into this now, as it'll be explored in detail in future talks. But John's letters are written to reinforce the key underlying theme of the and principles of the Christian faith, the importance of distinguishing between truth and falsehood, and that the Christian faith brings light, eternal life, and above all, love. So now let's explore the passage which George has just read. It's divided into two parts, which are very different, but they have connected theme. I love the way it starts. John is determined to emphasize that what he is writing about Jesus is true and really happened. So he lists the historical and his audible, his visual and his tangible credentials. What was from the beginning, since eternity, that's Jesus, John heard him speak. He saw him with his own eyes and he touched him with his own hands. John was there with Jesus. I find the thought that he touched Jesus absolutely mind-boggling. For several years, he lived with Jesus, one of the innermost group with Peter and James. He refers to himself as the one whom Jesus loved 5 times in his gospel, confirming his intimacy, very important word, with Jesus. This really is first-hand experience. And by the time he wrote his letters, he was probably, or at least possibly, the only one of the original 12 apostles still alive, as one or even 2 generations had passed since Jesus' death. So his credentials to his readers then, and even more so to us now, are vitally important. Jesus, who is referred to as the Word in John's Gospel, do you remember, in the beginning was the Word, the Word was with God, and the Word was God, is here called the Word of Life. Here, John is testifying and proclaiming the very strongest words, that Jesus, the very source of life itself from the beginning, and who is sovereign over life, is alive now. John wants us to be in no doubt about that. He then brings in a key word used 4 times in the next few verses, and this is fellowship, the Greek word koinonia. It is almost untranslatable. It can be described as an intimate spiritual connection and union with each other and with God as we share the life that Jesus brings. It can be seen in deep, genuine friendship and honest, trustworthy communication. It is being real before each other and before God. Jesus gave us a good example of this in John 15, when he says that he is the vine and we are the branches. I am struck by the thought that we all share the same sap, as I said, I think last week, week before, with each other and with Jesus. The same Holy Spirit courses through all our veins. John calls this extraordinary spiritual unity koinonia, fellowship, and he longs for us to experience it, as he did, to make his joy complete. A modern Bible translation, the Message, says, "We want you to enjoy this too." That's the fellowship. Your joy will double our joy. Why does John emphasize this? John is passionate that we should hear and understand and share with him the greatest joy, eternal koinonia with each other and with God. It satisfies the deepest longings of our hearts, and it's what God made us for. The second part of this passage brings in new themes: light and darkness, sin and forgiveness, and the importance for this fellowship, this koinonia, of walking in the light. Light represents what is good, true, and holy. Darkness represents what is evil and false. We cannot experience koinonia and walk in darkness. We have to walk in the light. Now, how can we do this when we know that we, as mere humans, we can't help but sin? Well, verse 7 says that we can do this through the blood of Jesus, who purifies us from all sin. Well, what does this mean? When Jesus died on the cross, he took on himself all the sins of mankind, past, present, and future. He is the atoning sacrifice for our sins. So now, if we admit that we have sinned and confess our sins, God forgives us, our relationship with him is restored, and our sin slate is wiped clean. We need to keep short accounts with God, and when we sin, quickly confess and say sorry. It is an extraordinary balance. We are supposed to walk in the light and not sin, but we do. So while John encourages us not to sin, he assures us of God's grace and mercy if we do and we confess. This balance of a call to holiness alongside grace is right at the heart of the Christian life. So finally, how is this passage relevant to our lives today? Firstly, John is at great pains to emphasize that he knows what he is talking about and that we can trust him. I find this really striking and compelling. He was there. He touched Jesus. Jesus was and is real. We all go through ups and downs in our faith, moments of glorious belief and moments of the darkest doubt, just like those early Christians. But wherever we are in our spiritual walk, we can trust John and what he says, because he experienced the love and the teaching of Jesus firsthand. After all, he was the disciple who Jesus loved. Secondly, John's call to fellowship is a challenging but extraordinarily exciting call. Do we experience this fellowship, this deep spiritual intimacy with each other and with God? What do we need to do in order to grow in spiritual unity and deep, genuine fellowship? While sadly sin is part of all our lives, we can all be forgiven sinners. We don't need to wallow in guilt and self-condemnation. We can lay our sins before God, receive total forgiveness, and live in the light of unity and friendship again. This may need reconciliation with God, with ourselves, and with others. We need to be as one with each other and with God, and if we disagree, we must disagree well. As Christians, we should expect to be ambassadors of God and reconciled reconcilers, actively working to mend broken relationships and bring peace. Then we can model to the world through our relationships true fellowship and a glimpse of heaven on earth. And of course, a great way of experiencing this friendship is to join one of the many home groups that are being run in the benefice. And there are a number of them at different times of the day and different days of the week to choose from. And now back to Ephesus. Although it was once a great and flourishing city, it now lies in ruins, a shell of what it once was. John's letters, on the other hand, are as real, vibrant, and meaningful now as when they were written. So, let's continue to enjoy, absorb, and apply John's wisdom as we learn more from his letters in the coming weeks. Amen.